Hello, welcome to Kind Knows How to Read. I just started this channel like a week ago. I posted my first video. Check that out if you want to. I talk about my favorite books of 2021. I started BookTube because I was like, I need a platform where I can talk to people about books and bitch about all the books that I always bitch about to my boyfriend. Now I can bitch to you about these books instead. Or I can gush about all the books that I did like, or I could even be neutral about the books that I felt neutral about. And let's be honest, my boyfriend's still going to hear about these fucking books because I don't know when to shut the fuck up. So this is a September wrap up. I read 17 books this year. I've been doing that all day. I've been calling September the year, like a year. And honestly, it feels like it. I've read 17 books this month. I have thoughts about them. I had one star, two stars, 6 3 stars, 1 4 star, and 6 5 stars. That is unheard of. Are you kidding? 6 of them? Hi, she had a good reading month. But first, we have to start with the books that I didn't care as much about. So basically, I'm gonna break this up into how I rated the things. So we're starting with 1 stars. Let's go. The first book that I gave a 1 star is Very Nice by Marcy Dermansky. It's actually the only book I gave 1 star this month. It follows this character named Zahid Azam, and this character is an English professor and also a mess. And those are his 2 traits, woohoo, good for him. He also has written before a novel. He teaches this student named Rachel for his creative writing class. Rachel is a 19-year-old girl who is in his creative writing class. Yeah, he ends up having sex with a student. That's always a good start. He talks so much in his mind when we're in his point of view about how much he regrets sleeping with Rachel and how much he should not have let her continue on or let this all continue. I guess he just didn't think that the consequences were gonna catch up the way that they did, because things happen with Becca, Rachel's mom, and Zahid. They kind of have like a flirtatious thing. So he's like going through in his mind about how much he just doesn't like that he did that with Rachel. And I'm like, is that your reasoning for like regretting it? Because that's a stupid fucking reason. What, you want to bone her mom? So there's also another character, his name is Jonathan. Basically, Zahid and Jonathan are the only men in this book, and they both are equally as bad. But I absolutely, okay, Zahid, like, I did not like being in his mind, but I could deal with it. Jonathan, like, get me out of here. Like, get me out. I'm trapped. I'm in hell. I think this is what hell feels like. That might be a little dramatic. Okay. Basically, Jonathan has cheated on Becca. And then he acts like a big crybaby about it. He talks so much about how he regrets cheating and how he misses Becca and how she cooked his meals for him and how he took care of her. And he misses Rachel. And it's like, Jonathan, nobody feels bad for you. You cheated. You did this to yourself. Did you not think that there was consequences to the things that you did? You're like a 45-year-old man. Like, think for once. But I don't know what I expected really from a guy named Jonathan. Another thing about this book is that I don't think it used like one complex sentence. Fine, that might be a little hyperbolic. Basically, just like 5-word sentences throughout the entire thing. Like, I just flipped to this page randomly, page 81, and this is like an actual thing that's going on in Rachel's mind right now. Woohoo. My writing professor might be staying with us. Zahid Azam. I blushed again. The thought popped into my mind that my mother and I were in competition. It was a ridiculous idea. She was a million years old. She could have the dog. Like, do you not think that your audience can read a little bit more than that? It's insulting. Another thing about this book that I thought was insulting is the author tries to talk about like tries a little bit of political commentary in there, but she doesn't do it right. The way that every time something political is suggested or comes up, it is so forced and unorganic. Like, for example, like somebody's just like, oh, what am I gonna have for breakfast? And then the other person's like, I don't know, but that Donald Trump sure is something, ain't he? And I'm like, yeah, sure, fair, fuck Donald Trump. But like, also, what does that have to do with what's actually happening right now? It doesn't make sense. It doesn't flow. It never did. Also, the end of this book, I'm like, not gonna say what it was, but just know that I hated it and it was awful and it made me literally roll my eyes and be like, why did I waste my time doing that? If you like messy domestic type situations, you might like this book. And if you don't want anything like overly complicated with your language, but I love, like, I don't want to say I love flowery language because that's just not true either, but like, come on, give me something, please. You can't just like say what happened in such a flat way and expect people to fucking care. I'm sorry, you can't. Also, all of these characters are obviously really fucking shitty, and I think that that was like the point, that was what the author was trying to do, but she did like a really bad job. I think she was trying to do one of those things like, hate to love this character, but like you do anyways, or like unlikable characters, unreliable narrators, blah blah blah. I think that this author tried to dip her foot in that, but just did a really bad job of it. I'm sorry, excuse me, Marcy. The only person who can do an unlikable character and just do it so flawlessly is my friend Otesha Moshfeg. Cool, done with that one. That was one heck of a rage, that's for sure. All right, onto the two-star reads. The next book I read was Fishnets by Kirstin Inez. This book follows a woman named Fiona who has a sister named Rona who went missing 6 years ago. Fiona attempts to find her sister and find out what happened to her, find out any kind of answers because she hasn't had any for these 6 years. And while doing that, she finds out that her sister was a prostitute. I'm not gonna say too much about this book. It's relatively short and I don't wanna like overstep what I shouldn't say when it comes to this book. This book didn't really make me feel anything special. The end resolution was something that I was already aware of. It was basically like, prostitution is okay. My sister was a prostitute and that's fine. Sex work is fine. If you wanna do it, then that's fine. And I'm like, I know that already. I agree with this. We're on the same team, so I don't know. It's a book that I read. I will say I do like the cover. I think that's a pretty cool cover. It's weird to me though that like her last name is lowercase, but I guess I can't really say anything because I literally type in all lowercase all the time. And hi, I'm an English major, so who cares? The next book that I gave a 2-star was a book called Written in the Stars by Alexandria Bellefluer. This book follows two girls who are both bisexual. Their names are Elle and Darcy. They are set up on a blind date by this guy named Brendan, who is Darcy's brother and Elle's coworker. The date doesn't go well. They are very, very opposites. Darcy is no nonsense, no emotion, work hard type person, and Elle is feelings over logic type person. And this makes for a very interesting dynamic when they are in communication with each other. Elle is an astrologer and Darcy doesn't believe in zodiac signs, and their first date, they have an argument about that. That actually sounds like me and my boyfriend's first date. We also argued about veganism. Darcy is plagued by the fact that Brendan continuously wants her to have a significant other and is always trying to find ways to get her to have a significant other. I thought that this was weird, and I will also get to that later in a second, but Darcy would rather be single, it says throughout the book, basically. She is hiding from emotion, sure, but she also is just like, I don't want to date people. And it's weird because Brendan does not respect that. I wrote in my like Goodreads when I was updating this, I was like, Brendan is weird. Because here's the thing. You can be as close as you want to be with your fucking siblings, obviously. You can be as close can be. But when you start worrying so much about your sister or your sibling getting laid, maybe you need to like take it back a bit. Because Brendan was obsessed. They called him like a hopeless romantic, so like let's just call it that, but like it seemed weird. Like, to me, it was, I say obsessed, and maybe that was hyperbolic, but, like, I was like, this is off. I don't care how close I am with my siblings, I'm not acting this way towards them. I get being happy when somebody is finally in a relationship and, like, that's what you wanted for them, or you see that they're happy or whatever have you. That's different than, like, forcing. For example, in it, he was like, we're going to the speed dating thing and you're going, and if you're not going on Tuesday, you're going on Saturday, which is like the backup date. So you're going one of these 2 days and with me to speed dating. And I'm like, catch me dead going to speed dating with my fucking brothers. Catch me dead. I talked about how she's an astrologer. So yeah, throughout the book, Elle is talking about astrology and is super, super about astrology, and so am I. So interesting that, right? It got me weirded out when it was like, oh yeah, I'm an astrologer. There was like inserts that were like, what kind of rom-com are you based on your zodiac sign? What brunch food are you based on your zodiac sign? I'm a Scorpio and mine was bottomless Bloody Marys. So that's the only qualm I have about the astrology thing, I think. I can't say that I was like disappointed in this book or anything, because I wasn't really expecting much of anything. I was just like reading it. Also, I do have like a weird relationship with when it comes to romance books, so me not liking it is not a surprise at all. It'd be way more of a surprise if I did like it. All right, now on to the 3 stars. The first book that I have here is New York 2140 by Kim Stanley Robinson. This is a chunky, chunky book. It took me like 4 weeks to read it, which is not the typical speed for me. I read this with an audiobook, and in the audiobook, it had like different voices for the characters, and I think that was really helpful because this is a very character-centered book. The book follows 9 or 10 like different characters as they exist in New York underwater, like New York in the year 2140. Basically, it's like, this is what's gonna happen because of global warming. My favorite character to follow throughout this book was the citizen, because he had a lot of world building in his sections. He was basically looking at New York at a critical level and just talking about it. He was rather a pessimist, but he was just talking about what New York truly is, what he's seeing it for. Just because New York is underwater does not mean it stops being New York. He didn't like New York before. He's saying that it's the same thing underwater. And even though this big life-changing thing has happened and like it knocked out like so much of the population, we're still here. It's still just the nuances of everyday life, and it's as simple as that. And he, like I said, that was like a pessimistic and existential way of looking at things. He also like referred to all the rest of the characters as like the heroes. He's like, let's get back to what our heroes are doing. And it's like interesting that he doesn't really see himself in that at all. People are having like adventures while they're like, you know, it's a narrative about, you know, the things that they're doing, the people that they're meeting. They all combine together eventually and you know, get to know one another, and they're all mutual friends, basically. Yeah, like I said, the audiobook was really good, but it was 23 hours, so that's something. I recommend this book if you like dystopian, sci-fi, or futuristic. The next 3-star book that I have is The Wife Upstairs by Rachel Hawkins. I don't know what to say about this book. It's a 300-page book. It's a thriller. I predicted what was going to happen. I got it from the library. Basically, it follows this girl named Jane, and she is a dog walker, and she walks these dogs in this rich neighborhood. And then in this rich neighborhood, there's this guy who she meets, and then she becomes like infatuated with him. They kind of have a thing going. The thing is, this guy's wife just died kind of recently, or she was in a boating accident, and everybody's like still shooken up about that. And his wife has like, basically Jane has a big shoes to fill if she's going to be his wife. But I just want to say that I feel like this is a very predictable book. Like I said, it's literally like 300 pages, and it's called The Wife Upstairs, and it's a thriller, and reading the blurb and putting all of that together, I feel like you can probably predict what's gonna happen. I gave it a 3 stars, but I thought about it later on and I was like, maybe it's more of a 2 star, but I'm too lazy to change it on Goodreads, so it's a 3 stars for now. Whatever, pick it up if you want to, if you want something quick and easy and fast paced. But that's all that this might have going for it. The next book that I have here is a book called Sugar Run by Mesha Maren. This book is about a woman named Jody who gets arrested when she was 17 for a manslaughter charge. She does not expect to ever be out of the prison, but then 18 years later, she's out and she's like, well, I don't know where the fuck to go. So she goes and tries to find somebody that she once knew. And it's a journey of her trying to find that person. And she also falls in love on the way. And it's really cool. And it's also like, it's sapphic. So yay. I've got to be honest. The biggest reason I picked this book up is because it mentioned the place that I live in it, West Virginia. So here's the thing. Yeah, I went to the bookstore that's like down the street. And I saw this book and it was like, books that are set in West Virginia, and I'm like, okay, that's kind of cool. And then I read the back and I was like, oh, she's in prison, that's kind of cool. Like, not cool, but you know. So I was like, okay, whatever, putting those two things together, I feel like that would be like, that would make for an enjoyable book, or at least for me it would. I got a mediocre book. Also though, mention my hometown, the place where I grew up and lived and existed and went to school and shit and ate. Really love the cover. It's solid. The next book that I read and gave 3 stars is To All the Boys I Loved Before by Jenny Han. This book I liked a lot more than I expected to. It's about a high school girl named Laura Jean, and she writes notes to all the people that she's had crushes on before, and she writes all of her feelings until they're like no more, till she feels like they're seeped out of her, and then she puts them in a ultra like safe hiding spot. One day these notes get out mysteriously, and all the boys that she loved before now know that she once loved them. One of those being a super duper hands off, get away from, like, big time no crush. Like, you, like, this can't happen. That's a, you know better, Laura Jean. I would say who it is that she has a crush on, but I think that would be a spoiler. Like I said, I enjoyed this book so much more than I thought I would. The reason that I decided to finally pick this book up was because I saw a tweet, and I'm gonna put it right here. This is not this. And it was saying, To All the Boys I Loved Before is not She's All That remake. It's not The Kissing Booth, and it's not Sierra Burgess Is a Loser, which all of those things, if you didn't know, are like Netflix originals. And obviously they're talking about like the movies there, but I kind of like went my own way when I was like thinking about it. I was like, I thought about the books. I was like, I was always under the, like, I was always excited for that kind of concept. I've heard about the movie and I was like, oh, that sounds so interesting. Like, she just writes notes to the people that she used to like love. And I'm like, that's something I do. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I've written notes about people that then hopes to like purge all of my emotions for them out of me, and I really like that aspect of it. So I think that that makes it a better romance than I would typically go for. I also love the familial aspect in this book. Laura Jean was pretty close to her two sisters, and it was really pure until it wasn't, when they like had arguments and the inevitable, like, you know, downfall of their relationship. But they're still siblings, so everything, you know, usually works itself out. It was very, very cute. I also want to say that I think that this might have done the fake dating trope and made me realize what it's supposed to be. I never understood the fake dating trope, and I didn't talk about this when I was talking about Written in the Stars earlier, but like, that had a fake dating trope. I do not understand those tropes. There's no way that I would ever try to fake date someone. Are you kidding me? So the next book that I read was Theft by Finding, Diaries of 1977 to 2002 by David Sedaris. This book is a bunch of entries that David Sedaris did, and he started them in 77, and they went all the way till 2002, and he has a second volume of this book out, and I'm pretty sure it goes to 2020. From 2003 to 2020. So that is super freaking impressive and crazy. Basically throughout it, he just like writes as much as he can, like actual entries of things that happen throughout the day. Sometimes he'll like write overheard conversations, things like that. I thought it was such an intriguing thing to read. I think this book and the idea of like the diary thing really just gives you a deep dive into what the years were like. And it's like, I was reading it and I was like, wow, this is such an 80s vibe. This is such a 90s vibe. And it's like, well, yeah, duh, because he was literally living it. He was just like existing. I really like 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, like learning about the history between those years and looking at what the world looked like. I don't know why, that's just like intriguing to me. And this book gave me just that, and it was perfection. And it's just so interesting to just like take a like, just like a little portal and just look inside of what it was like then. And I love that shit. And I mean, I guess that's why I read. That's why we're here, baby. This book begins when he is 21 years old and he's an English major in college. And I'm like, ha, me too, David. Me too. I need to start my diary now. The next 3-star book that I read was Outlawed by Ann North. This book takes place in the late 1800s and it follows this girl named Ada. Ada gets sent off to get married at a pretty young age, as most of the women do during this time. And she soon finds out that she's unable to have kids, or as they refer to it, as barren. Whenever this happens and an individual was barren, it was very often a thing where they were accused of being a witch and they were going to be hung. So Ada's mom did what she could do and took her to this place where barren women are accepted, but they're basically like, well, outlaws. They're living their own life and like kind of against the grain of society. This book is relatively short, so I don't want to say too much. All I will say is that I personally did not expect to like the book as much as I did. I didn't think that this was going to be something that I was going to be that into, but I was. I mean, like I said, it was a solid read. It was a 3 stars, whatever. Also, the cover is really, really pretty, and I just really like the cover a lot.
All right, 4 stars.
The first 4-star book that I have is Betty by Tiffany McDaniel. I actually just recently wrote this book. I sure have thoughts. This book is about a little girl named Betty who is half indigenous. Her mom is white and then her dad is Cherokee. And Betty realizes at a young age that life is not all that is cracked up to be. She has thing after thing happen to her, and the entire family really just has thing after thing happen to them. And it's like really sad. I think that this would probably be able to be considered like torture porn, honestly. I cried a few times. I don't think that that's actually saying that much for me, because I feel like I cry a lot. Like, I also cried to all the boys I loved before, so... I will say, if before reading this, if you want to read this book, it talks about a lot of things, and it goes into detail about those things, and sometimes that might be hard to read. If you want a tearjerker, this is a book that I would recommend for that. So, if you feel like maybe you can't cry anymore, I don't know. Pick up Betty. See if you cry. That was my only 4-star book, so you know what that means. We made it, baby! On to the 5-star books. I still can't believe that I had 6 5-star books. That's kind of crazy. First one that I have, I technically gave it a 4.75, and that's They Never Learned by Layne Fargo. Look. This book, I read it, I like binge read it. I was enamored. I was very, very intrigued by, first of all, the premise. Basically what happens is there's this professor, this English professor who kills sex offenders around the campus. I don't want to say too much because I am scared of spoiling anything, and the like there's a lot to spoil. The twists in this book were things that I was not expecting. Like, I thought I was predicting it. I was like, oh, easy, this is what's gonna happen, duh. It did not happen the way that I thought it was gonna happen. I was caught by surprise, and that makes for a good book for me. Honestly, when I'm caught by surprise, or like literally there was a reveal that made me, I was like, for a whole page and a half, I was like, I cannot believe this just happened. I can't believe this is some information that we just obtained here. It also has a sapphic relationship, so that's cool. The next book is A Tale for the Time Being by Ruth Ozeki. I actually talked about this in pretty good length in my last video, where I talked about all the books that I just really, really liked, and this was one of my like new favorite books. I enjoyed this book a lot. Go look at my last video to see what I think about it. Even though I'm probably not that coherent in that video about this either, I just think it's a beautiful book. I'm sorry. It's hard for me to be coherent when I'm excited about things, you know? Next book is Station 11, which I read this month and also talked about in my last video. Yeah, I just had a really good reading month! The next book that I absolutely loved and gave 5 stars was Cultish by Amanda Montell. Cultish is a non-fiction book about cults, if you can believe it. If you watched my last video, you know already maybe that I really, really like cults. I enjoy a cult novel when one is put in front of me. They're always something that's just been super intriguing to me, and it's super intriguing to a lot of people, and so intriguing that people are part of them. Cultish goes on and talks about cult-leaning things such as Soul Cycle and QAnon, and then she also talks about social media, and then she talks about the typical cults such as Heaven's Gate and Scientology. And she also mentions MLMs, which is my favorite section of the book. The next book that I read was Long Way Down by Jason Reynolds, and what a delight this was! Wow! This book was so amazing. Basically, it takes place within a minute where this kid named Will decides if he is going to kill his brother's shooter or not. And it's just amazing. It's written in this, like, you know, format, so it's very quick to get through. It took me like an hour and a half to read. It's super accessible. I think that like everybody who can get their hands on this book should, and I mean hands figuratively, like I mean ebook, audiobook, physical, whatever you have to do to consume this. Wow, it is so amazing and beautiful, and I have thought about it like at least once a day. It definitely left a punch. It left an impact for being so short. I was pleasantly surprised. I heard that it was good, but I didn't know it was gonna be this good. I cried, and I had a whole range of emotions while reading this hour and a half long book. Now that is talent. Black Enough, it is an anthology of a bunch of different stories about a bunch of different, and written by a bunch of different people. One of those people being Jason, who I just talked about. My favorite story out of all of those books was a story called Oreo, and basically it's about this girl named Jody who gets called an Oreo by her cousin. So you're like black on the outside but white on the inside. Jody's dad was like, basically had a lot of internalized racism to work through. My dad and this dad could probably get along. That's all I'm gonna fucking say. To add that I had 17 books, I did also finish Walden by Henry David Thoreau. I have nothing to say about it. I didn't rate it. I didn't care for it. It was for school, and I'm not even like in school anymore. So who cares? I don't. I just finished it, and I just wanted to put out the fact that I did, in fact, finish it in this month. Wow, look at you. You made it to the end of the video. Thank you so much for watching the entirety of this video. Wow, good for you. I'm so sorry that it was this length. I don't know what length it's gonna be, but I'm just apologizing just in case. I just read a lot, and I think that my wrap-ups are going to probably be like a longer format. So for future reference, just sit there and you can enjoy your food while I am on the screen raving and raging about various books. And you can like and subscribe. That would be really cool. And let me know, have you read any of these books that I talked about, because I would love to talk about them in the comments, or if you want to message me in Goodreads, my Goodreads will be in the description, obviously. So if you want to like message me on Goodreads, just like friend request me there, I'll accept it, and we can talk about any of these books that you want to, or any books that you think I should read based on what you've seen so far that I might like.